Good morning, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us today on this webinar by Tina Boogren on self-care. I am Justin Voigt. I'm the events manager here at Hawker Brownlow Education based in Melbourne. For those who aren't familiar with Hawker Brownlow, since 1985, we have empowered F-12 teachers and education professionals with the tools and skills, such as these webinars, to improve classroom and raise student achievement. And without any further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Tina Boogren. Tina, as an educator, is a finalist of the Colorado Teacher of the Year, and she's received the Outstanding Teacher Award 7 years in a row. Tina is the author of In the First Few Years, Reflections of a Beginning Teacher. Tina has presented at the school, district, state, and national level, and has been featured speaker at the International Reading Association National Conference and Barnes & Noble Educators Night. So thank you again for everyone attending. I will hand you over to the wonderful Tina.
Perfect, thank you. Hi everyone, good morning. I am so thrilled to be here with all of you. I wish, Justin and I were chatting before we started, I am thrilled that we can do this, but oh my goodness, what I wouldn't give to be able to be there in person with all of you. So let's get started. And here's what we're gonna do to get started. We'll be able to kind of try out that chat box that Justin mentioned. So what I'd love for you to do is jump over to that chat box and answer the following question, if you will. I'd love for you to share what are three things that you are feeling really grateful for today. I'm gonna play a little music while you're doing that, give you a little bit of time to be able to do that. But when you're ready, go ahead and jump in that chat box and share what you're grateful for today. Perfect. Thank you, you guys. So to start us off here, let me back up. My cursor got crazy here. So to start us off, yes, I'm so grateful to be here with all of you to share with you the content of these two books. So this time that you're giving to me, this time is all about you. So I really want this time to feel like a gift, because here's the deal. In this crazy time that we are living in, I would argue that we need to double down on how we're taking care of ourselves first, before we start thinking about our students even, which feels a little uncomfortable for us as educators, but I'm gonna prove my point as we go through, that by taking this time to really focus on our own self-care, wellness, happiness, that end result will have a direct correlation to the students in our classroom, but it starts with us. So this time, I want you to dig in, because this is going to be all about you. So to start us off, I first want to say thank you for being awesome. You guys, I can't think of a more challenging time to be an educator than right now. And if no one's told you today how awesome you are, hear me say this. You are incredible. I am in awe of the work that you are doing. Who would have thought that we would have the year that we are having? So hear me say thank you. And also know that if you are feeling like this, that emotion, all of these emotions are welcome here as well. In fact, most people, educators, will take a look at this and say, oh, how about all of the above? Yep, I totally get that. Things are really hard right now. So I am Tina, and that is a picture of the airport, because typically, I spend the majority of my time flying around to do these workshops in person, but I have been grounded. So here we are. So welcome. I am in Denver, Colorado. I'm honored to be here. It is 4:30 in the evening for me. So, and it's full on summer here. So it's crazy to think about how we're able to stay connected this way, which I love. My educational background, I was a teacher for a long time, English teacher, mainly at the middle and high school level here, which would be considered your secondary and senior secondary. And then from there, I moved into, I was an instructional coach and got to work a lot with brand new teachers and coach across the board. And then I moved into administration. So I worked at the middle school level for what we would call an assistant principal position, and then have been doing this job with a solution tree, Marzano Resources, for about 10 years now. And this content that I'm honored to share with you today, this is the content, this is my hill to die on. I am adamant about starting here before we do anything else, starting with taking how we take care of ourselves. So again, I am thrilled and honored to be here with all of you. So our structure for this time together, we know we're getting a little bit of Zoom fatigue, I am certain. So we have, I know how hard it is to be able to sit in these trainings. So here's what's going to happen. I'm going to make sure that this is an interactive training. That is going to increase our retention and ensure that we don't kind of wander off. As I have sat on your side for so many of these trainings, here's what I know. Couple things here, that it's really, really easy in your mind to be like, okay, I'm going to kind of pay attention to this webinar, but I'm going to get these things done over here. And then we know that multitasking is a myth, right? We cannot pay attention to two things at once. So like I said, I'm going to invite you to really go all in for this. And to, it's not a lot of time together, but you know what you need to keep your own energy level up. If you need to stand up, if you need to take your device and go sit outside for a minute, you're welcome to do that. And then finally, I want you to just grant yourself permission that for the next about 45 minutes or so, you are going to allow yourself to do one thing and one thing only, and that is to go all in. So here's what I mean by that. It is, you can put the to-do list off to the side. You can put your phone upside down if you need to. You can put a screen in front of a child as you need to, and just allow yourself to really go back in to absorb this content. I am all here with you. I've got everything laid out, so I am ready to go all in with you. So thank you. Thank you. So I'm going to share some research up here on the screen that I'm going to ask you to take a look at. This is really powerful research. I think we know it intuitively, but it's really interesting to read it put this way. So stated differently, we know positive emotions not only put us in a better mood, but what this is telling us is that it actually changes our brain when we have the positive emotions. It allows our thinking to be more creative, flexible, and inclusive, which I can't think of a more important time than the challenging time that we are living in right now when we need our brains to be open to new ideas, be able to think creatively and flexibly. So this is really powerful. And it's hard because we know emotions are contagious. In fact, let me put this next piece of research up here. This says, you know, basically that emotions are contagious. And right now in the entire world, there is a collective sense of anxiety that is very contagious. There's a lot of fear. There's a lot of negative emotions, and so we have to work really hard to remind ourselves that the positive emotions are also contagious. And so if we can take time at the start of the day, various times throughout the day, to really get our brain in that positive space, that is going to help everything. Not only help the people around us, which includes colleagues and friends and family members and students, but it also puts our brain in a different place, which is really powerful. So that's the first thing to kind of hold on to. So thank you for taking time to kind of dig into that gratitude over there. I think gratitude is one of the fastest ways to get us in that positive state. So when I talk about self-care, the foundation that I utilize for this is going to be familiar to you, which is nice. So this is just tapping into prior knowledge that you already have. You don't have to go and learn or memorize some sort of new framework. You already know this. The slide I'm going to put up is updated for 2020, you will see. But this is the foundation that I utilize, which is Maslow's hierarchy of needs for this lovely year that we're living in. here's why I utilize Maslow's hierarchy to talk about self-care and teacher wellness. Number one, we already know Maslow. You might not think about it every day, but you've learned this along the way. So again, this is just tapping into that prior knowledge. And number two, there's a lot of research behind this, and it's helpful to think of this pyramid through two different lenses. So number one, we can think about the levels of the pyramid in terms of our students. So when I talk about social emotional learning, in fact, I'm going to do another webinar on this in about a month, where we look at the levels of Maslow's hierarchy through the eyes of our students. And we think about how can we as educators meet the needs of our students at each of these levels. But the important part to remember is we can't do that unless we have the level solid ourselves. And that's the lens that we have here for this session today. We have to get ourselves solid and steady and living on this even foundation ourselves so that we can make sure that we're meeting the needs for our students. So all I did, for metaphor's sake, is I took Maslow's hierarchy, as you see here, which is the typically shown to us in the pyramid format, and I just turned it into a ladder. I was an English teacher, I love a good metaphor, so a ladder. So if you wanna snap a photo of this, you're welcome to. The slides, as you can see, are gonna come out later, but I love the idea of just take a picture of this so you've got it. So the thinking behind creating the ladder here is that we want to live at the top of the ladder, right? We wanna be at the self-actualization transcendence levels, but it's really hard to get to those levels, and we can't stay at those levels for very long if the bottom four rungs are broken or depleted or worn out, or in this current time, maybe ripped off, broken, and thrown into a fire, right? So we have to get these levels really, really solid, the first four levels, to get to the top. Now, what I did, keep your cameras out, what I did is I then converted each of the rungs of the ladder into self-reflection questions. Here's the thinking behind this. This is what I propose we do for our kind of self-care plan. This is what I do. So I literally set an alarm on my phone. And when that alarm goes off, and I have it set for three different times, I have it set for one time in the morning, one time in the afternoon, and one time in the evening. And the alarm goes off, which is my reminder to stop and check in with myself. That right there is a radical move, right? Most of us check in with everyone else all day long, and then we are so depleted and worn out at the end of the day that we don't even have the energy to do anything for ourselves. So this is allowing us to check in with ourselves during the day. And how we do that is we literally ask ourselves the questions of the ladder, starting at the first rung, the bottom rung. If, and it's just a yes or no response. If we respond with a yes, we get to keep moving up the ladder. If we respond with a no, we stop right there. We don't go any further, and we commit to doing something to turn that no into a yes. And for most of us, we get stuck at these bottom levels here. Think about how many times during your day that if you actually paused and checked in with yourself and you said, okay, are my basic needs met? How often could you say, ooh, I haven't used the restroom once today. I have only consumed coffee. Oops, I forgot to eat lunch. Or wait, how many mini Snickers bars can I count for lunch, right? And so we don't go any further. We actually pause right there. And then the self-care commitment is that we do something to turn that no into a yes, so that eventually we get some habits and routines formed that we can consistently answer yes to these questions, which means that we get to go to the top levels. And when we get to those top levels, that's when we really feel like, look at those questions, that we feel like we are living our best lives. And that top question, that is that transcendence level where we feel like, oh my gosh, not only do I feel like I'm living my best life, but I feel connected to something outside of me. That is where our why for becoming an educator is at that top level. So if we can keep tapped into that, I would argue helps to keep us from burnout. So our plan, my plan for our time together is I want you to leave this session with your own personalized self-care plan started so you can just roll with this. So this is the format that I recommend using. And again, go ahead, just take a photo of this. It's super simple, or just jot it down somewhere. It's really not complicated. You can see we've just got the levels and I put those questions. And then I just wanted you to just start jotting down. I'm going to share with you at least one strategy for each level so that when we say goodbye to each other, you're able to go and get started right away. And then you will be able to add to this as you move about your day and you think about, you'll have a deeper understanding of each of these levels after this session. So you'll be able to add different strategies that feel right to you. And that's going to be, that's our plan here. Okay. So here's what I'm going to invite you to do. Before we start jumping into the different strategies, I'm going to put 30 seconds on this timer. Hopefully some music will play as well. And I just want you to, wherever you are, just stand up, stretch, move your body. It's time to kind of shake it off here. Right. Always feels good to move a little bit, especially during a webinar. Okay, so we're going to jump in and let's jump right into level one. So level one, very first rung of our ladder. This is where we have the three doozy areas, as I like to call them. So associated with level one are these three areas, diet, sleep, and exercise. And oh my goodness, for most of us this year, starting back in March when the pandemic began, most of us, I think, would say that maybe all three of these, if not at least a few of these, were absolutely impacted. Diet, sleep, exercise. This is really hard. I want to remind us that when we think about the first two levels of the ladder, so the physiological needs, what we're talking about here, and then when we get to safety needs, if these levels aren't solid, we cannot even pay attention. So let me say that again. If our physiological and or safety needs are not solid, we cannot even pay attention. So this may explain if you are having trouble concentrating, if you feel like, oh my gosh, I used to be able to do this. No problem. Why am I having so much trouble reading a book? Why am I having trouble watching this movie? It's because collectively our level one and two of our ladder have blown up in these last few months. So we could spend 3 weeks talking about diet, sleep, and exercise. We know that we need to focus on these areas. But for the sake of a baby step starting place, I have one thing that I am going to recommend for us. And that is to drink more water. Now, I bet some of you are crushing this, but for some of us, myself included, I have to purposely work at this. The reason why I'm starting with, I know you know to drink water. No one's like, oh my gosh, I didn't know I was supposed to be drinking water. I know we know, but a lot of times there's a difference between what we know we should do and what we're actually doing. And to me, this is a really great starting place because it's simple. We can start right now. Literally, I want us to start right now. Grab your water. And if you don't have water, I want you to run as fast as you can to go get it and then come back and take a big drink of your water. Yes, and I know water is really hard because we don't get much of an opportunity during the day. But if we build up slowly, we can get there. And I think I have this conversation all the time with educators. And so I can't think of another profession, very few, maybe nurses, right? And us, where we choose to not drink water because we don't have the opportunity to go to the restroom during the day. It's crazy, right? So we got to, maybe we start small and build up. So let me just remind us of some of the reasons why water is so good for us. Again, I know we know these, it's just good to be reminded of them. And it's available to us and it's super simple. We can start this baby step right now. So here's what I'm going to ask us to do. I want us to kind of do some crowdsourcing here. So in that chat box, I'm just going to put 60 seconds on the timer, and I would love for you to share what are your best tips and tricks for ensuring that you drink enough water during the day. For me, a straw makes a huge difference, right? So whatever it is, I would love, love, love if you could just pause and in that chat box share what are your best tips and tricks to make sure you drink enough water. Oh my goodness. Yes, I love these ideas. Absolutely. Who put, oh gosh, I want to make sure that I get this one. Yes. Drink as I think. That's genius. Yes. Standing in front of the classroom. Drink while you think. That is a great idea. Yes. I love these. These little tiny things can have a huge impact. Having an accountability partner is huge. You got it. I have some more tips on the screen here for you as well, just to get us started. Here's the deal. Again, we know this is no surprise. You didn't come here to learn to drink water. It's a reminder though. And if we can take teeny tiny little baby steps, particularly around diet, sleep, and exercise, that's what we need. We just need to start getting a new routine going, and that will help us feel better. And in order to keep going and making changes, we just need to feel a little bit better. And right now, it would be really normal if we're not feeling really great. And so I always say, go back to the basics, do a self audit and think about which area, diet, sleep, and exercise, which area would be the area that you want to spend some time thinking about more. Maybe it is starting with drinking more water. Maybe you want to double down on your sleep. Maybe you want to, and that's hard. My sleep has definitely been impacted. I've had to commit to turning the news off, that I set an alarm to go to bed. I pick up a book and I read, right? All those things, again, that we know, but we may have, in the chaos of the world right now, we may have gotten away from the things that we know work for us. So just a reminder to kind of go back to basics there. I also want to share with you, if you have not seen this, this is a free app that you can have accountability for drinking your water. So here's how it works. So on this app, you get to tell it how much water, what your goal is. And by the way, general recommendation is that you take your body weight, divide that in half, and that's the minimum number of ounces to start with. And that is if you don't exercise and if it's not a warm day. So minimum number, body weight divided in half, minimum number of ounces. So you tell this app how much water you're going to drink, and every time you drink, you record it and the plant grows and it's super happy. And if you don't, it dies and you feel really bad. So it's good accountability. So that might be a good place to start. Oftentimes, if we track our behavior, we are much more likely to either create a habit or to break a habit. So that's a good place that we can start. So pause for just a second, if you will, and jot down anything else that you want to remember, or jump back into the chat box. Maybe you got some great ideas from other participants, and make sure that you can go back and add anything new that you learned or a new idea that you got. Jot it down so you've got a good starting place. All right. So that's level one, diet, sleep, exercise. Get back to basics, get back to what we know, being able to use those good foundational routines and habits there. And then we're going to move up to level two, safety. So safety, this level, oh man, when the pandemic hit, I remember having a conversation with one of my friends and I was like, oh no. The entire world's safety rung of the ladder just literally got broken off, broken in half, thrown into the fire. Like this, collectively, the entire world is feeling not safe. And let me explain what I mean by that. go ahead and take a look at that. So safety involves what you see in bold there, order, predictability, and fairness. So think about what's happening right now. All of those got we have no sense of predictability. We don't know what next month is going to look like. We don't know what next week is going to look like. And it's hard because our order and predictability all got kind of thrown around. Things are not, this world looks distinctly different right now than it did just a few months ago. And that's impacting this level. And fairness, think about, we could all list all of the things that are so unfair about what's going on. Graduations and trips. I was supposed to be in Australia about a month ago. It's very unfair, right? We can all list all of the things that are so unfair. And what happens when we feel that is our level two, our sense of safety, just gets depleted. And again, I'll remind you that levels one and two are physiological and safety needs. If those aren't solid, we cannot even pay attention. So here's what happens when we start to feel like, oh my goodness, that we don't have that sense of control, things don't feel fair. How this shows up for us is through, we start to feel anxious, or that sense, that anxiety. For some of us, so I deal with anxiety all of the time, and so my anxiety has been out of control when you throw a pandemic on top of it. For friends that don't typically deal with anxiety, this is a new emotion, and they're like, what is happening right now? So anxiety can show up in a number of different ways. As you look at this list, this could be an aha. You might look at this and go, oh goodness, I understand now what's happening. And or maybe it's not you. Maybe you see some of these characteristics showing up for family members or for students or for colleagues or for partners. And it makes perfect sense. This is all of these things are happening because collectively in the world, we have this sense of anxiety. There is so much angst right now. And so anxiety can show up in any of these ways. So first it's the recognition. Oh, that's what I'm feeling. And to also remind yourself, that's a perfectly natural response to what's happening. Now, the hard part is that oftentimes when we think about feeling anxious, it shows itself in our personality through these emotions or these behaviors. I share this with us because I think it helps us take a different look at humanity. So if we find that we are dealing with someone who's rude, it could be that they're feeling anxious. I thought of this often back when the world was normal and I spent the majority of my time in airports. You know, people aren't always on their best behavior in an airport. And what I discovered is I think that there's just a collective sense of not feeling very safe at an airport. Things are out of our control. A lot of people are afraid to fly. And now we see out in the world, this is just skyrocketed. So if you're feeling any of these, like if you're coming across in any of these ways, it makes perfect sense because our safety needs are most likely not solid right now. I also share this because this is so true for students. So when we take the lens of thinking through Maslow's hierarchy for students, one of the things that I remind us of is a student's misbehavior is never personal. Ooh, it's hard to even say because it feels personal. I know it feels personal. But let me say that again. A student's misbehavior is never personal. In actuality, their misbehavior is them demonstrating to us metaphorically that they have a need or needs not being met. And the hard part is every student will show that in a different way. Take a look at all of these pieces up here. We can see all of these behaviors from students. And so that might actually just be a manifestation that they don't feel safe, that they have this sense of anxiety. So I think that's an important thing to remember. So when that anxiety lands in us, I really want us to have two strategies in our back pocket that we can use immediately. So we all know how anxiety feels for us, and everyone probably has a different way that anxiety shows up. So for me, anxiety shows up, I feel it in my stomach, I get super anxious, I get real crabby, I'm a nightmare to be around, and I feel myself tense up, right? I start to wear my shoulders as earrings, I know when it's happening. So these are two of my go-to strategies straight out of the research that I want to offer to you. You may already know these, they might just be a reminder, or it could be could be something new that you can add to your tool belt here. So the first strategy is getting our breath back. So when we're in that state of anxiety, when we are on high alert, and anxiety can also be thought of as a fear of the future, a fear of the unknown future. And what our brain does is we start to ruminate, right? Well, if this happens, then this happens, then this happens. And that's when our breathing actually gets really shallow. This is what leads to panic attacks, right? When we cannot catch our breath, our breathing is from our chest, it gets really shallow. So what we want to do to calm our nervous system down, to get our brain in that calm place, is we want to be able to take a deep breath. And the breath that I recommend that we learn to do is we learn to do what's called a box breath or tactical breathing. So the research says that people with high stress jobs are taught how to do this. And so they list like firefighters and emergency room doctors and police officers and soldiers. And I want to say hello. I know some other people that have some high stress jobs that this might be a helpful tool to use as well. So this is when we feel the emotions, when we feel the anxiety, we feel the stress, if we can pause for a second and take at least one box breath, we might make a different decision in the next moment. This is powerful, especially in a classroom, right? If a student does something and it causes that anxiety, if we can calm ourselves, we might make a different decision in the next moment, which means we might avoid saying or doing something that we end up regretting. So here's how the box breath works. You're just literally breathing around the sides of that box. So it's a count of four on each side. So you're gonna start at a corner there and you're gonna inhale for a count of four slowly. You hold it at the top for a count of four, exhale for a count of four, and then hold it at the bottom. You will know that you're taking a deep breath because your stomach will actually expand, like it will physically expand. In fact, we're going to do this together. So I'm going to invite you right now to get yourself so that you can get both feet solidly on the ground and then sit up straight. I always say not so you're uncomfortable, but picture a balloon attached to the tag of your shirt, just helping you sit up straight. And this is gonna feel really goofy, but this will build some muscle memory around this, so you'll remember it when we close out this webinar. I want you to put one hand on your belly, and with the other hand, when you breathe, I want you to actually move around the box. So you can either do it in the air, you can do it right on your leg, on your computer, but I want you to feel, make that connection between, so when you inhale, your stomach's gonna expand, hold it at the top, exhale, your stomach will go back to your six-pack abs, right? After COVID, right? And then hold it at the bottom. So I want you to just practice breathing around that box. I'm not gonna count it for you. I find that that's really distracting. I'm just gonna set that timer. There's no music. I'm just gonna set the timer for 1 minute. And I just want you to practice what it feels like to take that breath. If you feel comfortable, sometimes it's kind of nice to close your eyes, do whatever works for you. I'm gonna breathe as well. We'll just take 1 minute, take some deep breaths. Right. Thank you. I know it feels real weird to put hand on your belly and make the box, but you'll remember that later on. It's just amazing to me that you probably got around the box a few times in a minute, so you don't even need like a full minute in order to just pause. And again, what you're doing is you're calming your nervous system down, putting yourself back in the present moment instead of doing that future tripping, right? That state of anxiety, it puts you back in the moment and allows you to make a different decision and also just gather your thoughts. it's really powerful. It's so powerful for students. So yes, I see. I think it was Rachel that posted like doing a lot of this with students. Absolutely. And in fact, the next webinar that I'm doing in about a month is going to be taking the same lens of using a lot of these strategies with students. For now, I think that we start with ourselves, so we've got this solid, but absolutely, we can't help as educators to think about, wow, how this is going to impact our students. You got it. So box breathing, there's one strategy. I said I was going to give you two strategies. So the other strategy is, again, it's a calming, oh, I forgot I put this in here just to make you giggle. So it's another calming strategy, because that's what we're looking for when that anxiety has crept in. So this one's called Take Five. So this one you may be familiar with. This is something a lot of people have this as a coping strategy. It's really helpful to prevent a panic attack is where I hear a lot of people utilize this. So the thinking behind this is, again, you feel the anxiety, so you pause and you take five. So this, you don't have to close your eyes, you don't have to do anything. This is all in your mind silently. You're just doing this up in your own head, but you're taking a moment to identify five things that you can see in the moment, four things you can actually hear, three things you can touch and feel, two things you can smell, and one thing you can taste. And all that's doing, by the way, is, again, it's keeping your brain from going down the path of ruminating and anxiety around the future. It puts you back in this very present moment and calms you down. Some people like this because it feels more concrete than just breathing around the box. So we're going to give it a shot. And again, I'm just going to set the timer for a minute. It probably will not take you a minute to do this, but the first, if you've never done this before, it takes a little bit longer because our brain is like, what can I hear in this moment? So I'm just going to, again, set that timer for 1 minute. You don't have to do anything in the chat box. This is just for you to just give it a shot right now. Do the take five, ready, go. Perfect. Good. So maybe that one felt a little bit better or easier than the breathing, or maybe the other way around. Just two tools that you can add to your tool belt there. So yes, Sarah, I appreciate your comment over here of that a minute feels so long. It does. Isn't it crazy that a minute feels painfully long to sit 1 minute? I absolutely get that. So it doesn't necessarily need to be a minute. It's more taking the breath, I think, that might help remove us from the anxiety of thinking about the time. And it also is why a lot of people really like the take five idea, because that just feels more concrete. And again, not associated with time necessarily. You just do the 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then check in with yourself. And if you're still feeling anxious, maybe rotate through it again. And the breathing, I would just say go around that box as many times as you need to feel, you will feel in your body when you start to release and relax a little bit, which is powerful. I also think this is hard for me too. I also think that we could all do ourselves a favor and learn how to sit still for a minute, right? It's cute. That is hard. It's really hard for me too. So I get that. I get that. So there you go. So levels 1 and 2, the most essential, the most important. Again, if those levels are not solid, we cannot even pay attention. So I hope you got at least one nugget, maybe two for each of those. And then before we move to level 3, let me just put a quick 15 seconds on here and let you again go ahead, stretch or take a drink of water or do both at the same time. Awesome. Thank you. Oh, I love that you saw a caterpillar outside the window. See, when we calm down, it's amazing what we can find out in the world. I love that. So level three belonging. Again, you'll notice a pattern here. I would argue that in this really unique and crazy time that we are in, all of the rungs of the ladder have been impacted. So we know we are hardwired for human connection. And that's one of the things that is so difficult about this time, about this notion of physical distancing. Notice that I call it physical distancing. So someone gave me that terminology instead of saying social distancing, because we want to stay socially connected, but we have to be physically apart. I just love that kind of change of mindset. So what I have up here on the screen, again, are just ideas that I have been doing this workshop all over the place. And I've just asked people to kind of share the question that I ask is, how are you staying connected even in this time of physical distancing? And I know that as restrictions kind of, we're lessening up restrictions, it's getting a little bit better, but we know we still have some huge challenges. So I put a whole bunch of ideas on the screen. So again, maybe you can steal a new idea. And then I'm also going to put 2 minutes on the timer, play a little music, and I would love, love, love to hear, or to read, I should say, your ideas. That's the question I'm posing to you. How are you staying connected with friends, with family members, anyone, in this time of physical distancing? And if you could share in that chat box, we might be able to add a few more ideas to our strategy list here. Yes, you guys, thank you. I love these ideas. And again, as you're reading the chat box, if you got some new ideas, jot those down. I love them. Yes. Just being really creative, that thank goodness we have access to technology, right? And just being able to reach out is huge. So this picture that you see up here, so this has become a ritual in my family. Who knew this would happen? So you've got my mom and dad, that's me and my husband and my sister and her girls. We, every single Sunday at 4:30 p.m., we have a family Zoom. We have done it the whole time. This picture is from early on. You can tell because my sister is bragging that they have toilet paper. So this has become a grounding ritual for us, a way for us to stay connected. Now, hopefully we reach out more during the week, but we all know at the very least, 4:30 on Sunday, you are going to find us being able to reconnect here, which has been essential, essential. One of the things that I always mention when we talk about belonging, just a reminder to reach out. Loneliness is huge. It's always huge at any time, but it is becoming an even greater issue now during this unique time that we are in. I encourage you to reach out, to think, to pause and think through your social circle. Is there someone that you have not heard from recently that you might just send a note? or you might pick up the phone or send an email and just check in on them. I think that's so important right now. So it's a good reminder to just think about, is there someone that, man, I haven't heard from that person in a while, or just I'm wondering how they're doing, and just reach out. When in doubt, reach out, right? That notion of staying connected is huge. Okay, so that's level three. Level four, we're going to keep moving here. So level four, esteem. Again, this one also is a problem during the pandemic. So I can't tell you how many educators that I have talked to over the last few months, people that have been doing this for so long, and then felt like they now feel like they're first year teachers again, because we were good. We had expertise. We knew what we were doing in the classroom, and then everything got topsy-turvy and turned upside down. And oh my goodness, that does a number on our esteem. So a reminder here, a huge reminder here, is that this is the first time that we have faced anything like this, most likely. This is probably for all of us, this is our first global pandemic. As Brené Brown would say, this would be what we would call an FFT, which is our effing first time. And the reminder is because anytime we do something new, something for the first time, we're not usually good at it. And as adults, we hate that. So you may feel like your esteem has been rotten, like things that you knew how to do, this technology, this everything that we've had to do different, you might feel like, oh my gosh, this is not the way I expected it. And that does a number on our esteem. So I want to give you a couple things to consider here. Number one, here's what the research says are super simple things we can do to boost our esteem quickly. And I bet some of you already have some celebrations here. I've met so many people that have talked about they're doing new hobbies. They're learning a brand new language. They're using an app to learn a new language, that they are mentoring someone, that they're helping someone through this, that they're learning, taking a class, learning a new skill. All of those, keep doing those, because that's helping our esteem for sure. Curating social media. So many people are saying, I'm done. I am done. It is not bringing me happiness anymore. I am closing down the social media. Absolutely. Or at least unfollow, unfriend, take back control of your social media. Definitely. What esteem boils down to is that voice inside our head. So I want you to remind yourself to talk to yourself exactly like you would talk to someone you love. So picture someone you love, picture a child. And if you hear that voice inside your head telling yourself things that you would never say to someone that you love, stop saying them to yourself. Now, I wish it were that simple. I wish we could just, you could say, okay, great, Tina, I'm done. I'm never going to do that again. We know that this takes a lot of work. So I want to give you a new vocabulary word to hold on to that you can use to talk back to that voice. So if you have more of an inner critic than an inner friend, when you hear that voice, and if it's negative, I want you to stop and I want you to remind yourself that you are flawsome. Yes, you've got flaws. We all have flaws, but you know what? You're still awesome. So I want you to lock that in. When you try something new, as we move around these new corners and the world changes and things, oh my gosh, we're just stumbling through this. Remind yourself that you are flossing, that you're surviving, you're doing it. Who would have thought, if someone told us in January that this is where we would be, you would have said there's no way, right? So we have got to remind ourselves that not only are we doing the best we can, we're doing a really damn good job. So here's what I want you to do next in that chat box. I want you to tell us why you are flossome. It can be anything. I'm putting some samples up here on the screen to get your brain going. In fact, you can write more than one down. I want to hear all the reasons that you are flossome. Don't be shy. Put them in that chat box. Tell us why you're flossome.
Thank you.
nice, you guys. I love these. This is gonna, there's gonna be music playing on the next slide. In the words of Ice Cube, check yourself, right? And I know, again, it takes a lot of work to really think about that voice inside of our head and that self-compassion work. But I just love that reminder to just the starting place is just that awareness of that voice inside your head and just stopping yourself. When you're saying things, those nasty things, the first place is to just stop. And I just love the idea of stopping and then override those negative feelings about ourselves with reasons that we are flawsome. Look at all those reasons that you just wrote down. I love this. They make me so happy, you guys. Yes. When you're feeling in doubt, make a list of all the reasons and the ways that you are flawsome and look at that every day. I love that. Okay. So, oh, perfect. Okay. This one's going to be quick. Justin, do you mind if I go a couple extra minutes to just get these last two? I'm going to do these two levels together here.
I'm pretty sure, Tina, by the looks at the interaction, I'm sure people don't mind you going over.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. I'll be quick, you guys. Thank you. So levels 5 and 6. So there's a distinct difference when we get to the top of the ladder here. So again, the first 4 rungs of the ladder are all about avoiding negative physical or physiological sensations. When we get to levels 5 and 6, ooh, this is the sweet spot. This is where we want to live. I usually get questions on levels 5 and 6 of feeling like at this point, if you're looking at your ladder and you're thinking, oh my goodness, I have some work that I need to do at the first 4 rungs, will I never feel like I'm at the top 2 levels? And the good news is no. Think about just for a moment, pause and consider. I bet that you have days where you feel like everything is great, even if you haven't gotten great sleep or you haven't gotten enough exercise or you feel a little disconnected. We can still have those good days. But the reminder is if we want to consistently have those days where we feel like, yes, I am living my best life and I feel really connected to my why, we're more likely to have more of those days when we get the bottom 4 rungs really solid. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you 2 quick hacks that you can do at any time to tap into levels 5 and 6. So even if you feel like the first 4 rungs of your ladder don't feel great, these are 2 things that you can do every single day, numerous times a day to help you feel better. So the 2 hacks, number 1, we've already done the first one. So the first one is gratitude. That's how I started us off on this webinar. The idea behind this is that our brain cannot hold on to negative emotions and gratitude at the same time, that the gratitude will override that and help us feel better at least for a moment. The second one is altruism. So the idea of doing something kind for someone else. And you guys have a job where you do this every single day. This, if we can remember that what we're doing is a giant act of kindness, that will help us tremendously. So what I want us to do is we're going to do a quick activity that's going to have us tap into both of these because I want you to feel these positive emotions. So we're going to hit gratitude and altruism at the exact same time. So what I want you to do is grab your cell phone. If you've got it, you can also do this on a good old-fashioned handwritten note. I want you to send a note of gratitude to someone else. I'm going to put 60 seconds on that clock. You might be able to send more than one. Just go ahead right now and send a note of gratitude to someone that you appreciate. Ready, go. nice. On behalf of whoever just received that note, thank you. You just literally made someone's day. And I bet if you check in with yourself right now, you feel pretty good because we did two things at once. We expressed gratitude and we made someone's day. So perfect. Okay. I really want to be respectful of your time. So the final thing that I'm going to ask us to do, this is important. I love the idea of the difference between interest and commitment. I'm going to actually pause so you can read that. And again, what I'm going to invite you to do is think about, we've shared a bunch of strategies. I shared some. You got amazing strategies from each other via that chat box. I want you to make a commitment to one thing that you're going to do differently. What's one commitment? Maybe it's drinking water. Maybe you're going to reach out to someone, whatever it is, one commitment. And I want you to put that in the chat box because there's something about publicly announcing it that we're more likely to actually do it. So go ahead when you are ready and make that commitment over in the chat box. Oh my gosh, thank you. I love these ideas, you guys. These are huge. Thank you. Yay. If this interests you, you guys, it's a sincere invitation to join me on my Facebook page. So my Facebook page is my happy place. So you can find me just literally facebook.com/selfcareforeducators. I post one invitation for you each day. I post a quote. I've got videos. I'm doing a free book study right now. I'm about to launch a podcast from there. So if this interests you, please, please join me over there so we can keep the conversation going. And I also want to share the rest of my contact information with you. So I am going to, we're about to move into the Q&A right now, but I just wanted to share this with you because sometimes it's easier, you know, you go about your day and you think, gosh, I wonder, I've got a question about whatever it is. Please email me is the fastest way to get a hold of me. And then there's my social media accounts. And then I'm going to invite Justin to join me once again and let's answer some questions. And I promise to be quick. Thanks for sticking with me, you guys.
Thank you so much, Tina. That was incredible. Some great interaction, which is always good to see.
Yay.
Which is awesome. As Tina did mention, on the 24th of July at 8:30 a.m. Melbourne time, we will be having Tina Boogren come back again for her next webinar on motivating and inspiring students. So please head to that and register. That'll be incredible. We will be sending some more marketing out for that too. So I might just wind back a little bit because Sarah did make, there was a couple of questions just relating back to towards the beginning where it was where you actually said you, three times a day to check in with yourself. There was morning, evening, and what was the other one? Or was it?
What did I say? Oh, what I do is I check in with myself in the morning, in the afternoon, and then in the evening. There's no right or wrong way to think through that. Maybe you just want to do twice a day, like once in the morning to get your day started. And then once maybe like mid-afternoon to check in during a school day is kind of nice if you've got time, which I know is hard, but yeah. And I always say kind of play around with it, see what works. If you know, start with, gosh, if we could, for most of us, if we could just remember to check in with ourselves one time a day, that would be a great place to start and then build from there.
Perfect. And also another one from Sarah, going back to the ladder, the second slide of the ladder, if you can't change it to a yes, what would you do?
Yeah, that's a great question. No, Sarah, I love it. Do not apologize. I love the questions. Thank you. It's a great question. So the thinking is that hopefully we can do something in the moment. So if we think about, you know, that safety level. So if we get to that question, we say, do I feel safe? And we realize we don't feel safe, then that's where maybe we could do the breathing exercise, the box breath, or we could do the take five to just help calm ourselves down again. So the hope is that you start to fill in as many go-to strategies as you can at each of the levels. I obviously have a lot more strategies in both of the books, and I share more on that Facebook page so that we can start to kind of just plug in, and you know then your go-to strategies, which I think is really individual. So for myself, let me give you a couple examples. I know, like, when I get to the first question, are my basic needs met? And I do a quick check-in. Usually what I find for me is that I have not drank enough water. If I don't consciously try to drink water, I haven't had, I know that that's a big one. And sleep. If I'm feeling off, if I don't feel like my needs are met, like in that level, it's usually sleep, because sleep impacts the others. This is true for most of us, probably. If I don't get enough sleep, then my diet is impacted because I'm constantly reaching for caffeine and sugar for the quick hit. And my exercise is impacted because I certainly don't feel like working out. So I know my baseline when I feel off is to go back to sleep. So the more that you kind of play with this, you'll start to figure out for yourself what you need, and then you can course correct more quickly, if that makes sense. So things don't get kind of so far off that we can kind of course correct, I think is helpful.
Okay, so that's no problems at all. Thank you so much again for everyone for your time this morning. Again, the recording will be sent out within 5 days. So again, thank you, Tina, so much for your time. I look forward to working with you again on the 24th of July.
Yes.
And thank you, everyone, for the amazing job you do out there as well.
Absolutely.
So please enjoy your day, and we'll speak to you all soon.